When we're creating the log file in the normal operation of a database system, this file can get very large or will become very large because we always append and append log entries. Now, of course, we want to avoid somehow that in the restart process after a crash, we have to read the entire file because it's very large. Checkpoints are introducing a mechanism to limit the amount of log entries to a recent subset of this big file. So hopefully we have to only read in this illustration this part of the log file instead of the entire one. We will investigate three different approaches. The first one is a very simple one called transaction consistent checkpoints. And then the second one is called action consistent checkpoint. And the last one is called fuzzy checkpoints. The idea behind transaction consistent checkpoints is very simple. At some point in time, the system wants to initiate the creation of such a transaction consistent checkpoint, which is happening at this point in time. And what the system is then doing is very simple. It allows the running transaction to complete, and it does not accept any new transactions. That means transaction 1 and 2, which are running at the time of the registration of the checkpoint, they are allowed to finish. And transaction 3, which is a new transaction, is not allowed to start. So it gets postponed to the time after we have created the checkpoint. So after the situation is now like this, so that the running transactions have finished, then we have time now to create our checkpoint. And then after the checkpoint creation happened, transaction 3 can start. And here we have another transaction that was starting after the checkpoint creation, T4, and this you see is still running when the crash happened. Now, how is this transaction-consistent checkpoint defined? Or what is the implications of this behavior? So what we do in creation of the checkpoint is to write all the modified pages to persistent storage, that means on disk in our scenario. So we can be sure that after this point in time, when the create checkpoint is done, that there is no left change made to the database buffer which is not reflected on disk already. We also know that the finished transactions here, well, they are done, right? They have committed. And since we have written their changes back to disk, we know we don't need any redo. And since we also don't allow any new transaction to start, there's also no need to undo any of these transactions. Again, why? Well, these have finished, and this one here was not allowed to start yet. So there are no losers, only winners. And we don't need redo for these winners because we have, at the checkpoint creation, written down all modified pages to persistent storage. Okay, what kind of, which parts of the entire log file do we have to consider after a restart, after this crash? Well, only those entries that have been created between the creation of the checkpoint and the crash. We don't have to consider any information from the past beyond that checkpoint creation. This means that for T1, T2, there's nothing to be done. T3 started here, right? And went until here. Well, that's a winner transaction, as we see, because it was completed before the crash happened. So we have to do redo for T3. And here for T4, we have to do undo, because it's a loser transaction. But again, this is all doable by the log entries written from the checkpoint creation time until the crash. So the old information is not needed. The problem with transaction-consistent checkpoints is that we require the system to be down for quite some time, because we have to wait for the still running transactions to be completed. Action-consistent checkpoints are trying to improve on this, and they're doing the following. We are not looking at entire transactions, but only at the individual modification operations within the transactions, which are highlighted here in this illustration by these colorful boxes. At this point in time here, we register the checkpoint. That means we tell the system that we want to create a checkpoint. Now, what the system is then doing is to wait for the individual modifying operations, like this one here, which is just started, to be completed, and is blocking all the additional actions not yet started. For instance, action one has still some actions which need to be executed, but they get postponed after the checkpoint creation. But for this here, we have to wait until it's completed, hence the name action consistent, like for the previous transaction consistent, where we waited for the transaction to be done. Here we wait for the individual actions to be done. At this point in time, this action has completed, and we can now create a checkpoint. And in this illustration here, and also by the intuition, it is clear that the downtime of the database system for the creation of this checkpointing technique, or for this checkpoint, is shorter than for the previous discussed approach. After the checkpoint, of course, the individual transactions continue with their actions not yet executed, and we also allow new transactions to start. And now the problem is to discuss which part of the log do we actually need. So here we have the checkpoint created, and here we have the crash happening. So which part of the log do we require at the restart operation? Well, first of all, do we need to know anything about the redo information for the older part? So for the log entries which are older than the checkpoint time? No, we do not need to have any redo information because we don't have to redo them, because we can be guaranteed that the changes by these modification operations are all written to disk, because this is what's happening at the checkpoint creation. So we do not require any redo information older than the checkpoint creation time. What about undo information? Do we require undo information which is older than the checkpoint creation time? Let's have a look at transaction 1, which is still running when the crash happened. And for sure, this is considered a loser transaction, so we have to make it undone. In order to make it undone, we have to make sure that we don't have any effect from this action, but also from this, 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 and this action in our database. And now it should be apparent that we indeed need undo information also from the older part of the log for those log entries which are, well, older than the checkpoint creation time. Until when do we have to go back inside the log? Well, if you're looking at all the active transactions during the checkpoint creation time, in this point that is transaction 1 and transaction 3, from those transactions we take the smallest log sequence number and we call this one min LSN. And this defines the point in time until we have to go back during the undo in our restart procedure. So we are storing the min LSN and the list of all active transactions at the point of the checkpoint, or the time point of the checkpoint creation. This is called action consistent checkpoints. The third technique is called fuzzy checkpoints. And here the idea is to limit the amount of time the checkpoint creation takes by not writing back the modified pages to disk, but to write down only the page IDs of those modified pages. And this can be done, of course, using sequential write to the log and not having to pay for random I/O when you're writing down or writing back the modified pages from the database buffer to the place on disk where they belong to. We're not writing only the page IDs of the modified pages, but also write down the oldest log sequence number that caused this page to be modified. We also say dirty. Now, if you're looking at the entire log now, and here, of course, the crash happened. This is the point of time where the checkpoint was created. Like in the previous cases, we now discuss what parts of this log do we need at recovery. For the undo process to start with, because it's similar or identical to the previous approaches, we have to go back from the crash time to the point in time that is identified by the smallest log sequence number of all transactions that were active when the checkpoint was created. And what about redo? Well, redo we still have to do, and also beyond, of course, the checkpoint creation time. Why, of course? Because, yeah, well, we did not write back the pages to the disk at this point in time, right? We only wrote down which pages were modified, but not the pages themselves. So we have to also do something about the operations that caused these pages to be modified and were not written to the disk. And how long do we have to go back in time to start our redo? Well, we look at the so-called min dirty page log sequence number. This is the smallest log sequence number for which changes were not yet written back to disk. So for all of these LSNs here, for the modified pages, we take the smallest one. You can also say the oldest one. And this is called min dirty page log sequence number. And from this point in time, let's say here, we have to do our redo for these transactions. Now, to illustrate the amount of data you have to read from the log for these three approaches, let's have a look at this slide. Here we have the checkpoint creation. Here, obviously, the crash happened. And now for the transaction consistent checkpoints, as we have discussed, we need to not go back beyond the checkpoint creation time. That means that the redo and undo phase, let's ignore the analysis phase because it's the same for all of these approaches. So here the redo and undo, they're only starting from the checkpoint creation time, right? Only this part of the log is needed. And for undo, this part of the log, which is the same, is needed. For action consistent checkpoints, the redo also begins at the checkpoint creation time because these actions that were previously executed have been written to disk, or the consequences, the modified pages of these actions have been written to disk. But for the undo, we have to go further to the past, namely to the time point defined by the min LSN. And now, finally, for fuzzy checkpointing, we have to go back for redo and undo in the past before the checkpoint creation time. The undo being defined as before for the action consistent checkpoints by the min LSN. And additionally, now we have here the min dirty page LSN, which defines the point in time where we have to start reading the log for our redo operation. Now you see that we have to read more here compared to here. And we have to also read more for the action consistent compared to the transaction consistent. But the observation is, or why are we doing these different techniques here? Well, the observation is that the transaction consistent checkpoints, even more than the action consistent checkpoint, causing a lot of time at the checkpoint creation. And the transaction consistent checkpoint, in contrast to the action consistent checkpoint, has also a huge downtime. Why is this important to avoid? Well, checkpointing is done during normal operations. So every, every few hours or something like this. And you don't want to have the database system to be down for some minutes. Because the assumption is that errors happen or crashes happen, but the precautions you're taking in normal operation should not overshadow then in the end the win or the gain when you're doing the recovery. And if you have something expensive, you're doing it all of the time, and only once per year you need this redo information, undo information from the log, then of course that was not a good investment to do this. Also, you're saving a little bit of effort because you're reading only small parts of the log compared to the other approaches. But at the creation, the continuous creation of these checkpoints, this was more expensive. That's the idea here. So one more comment on the analysis phase. I mentioned in the discussion earlier that we disregard that because it's the same for all the checkpointing mechanisms. And in fact, also for the three phases of restart, analysis, then redo, and then undo, we would not require the analysis phase because we learn about the winners and the losers in the redo scan. But why would you consider analysis phase at all? In some situation, it makes sense performance-wise to prefetch dirty pages that you need for the redo phase, and you're learning about these dirty pages during the analysis phase. And since the analysis phase is a sequential read of our log file compared to the random I/O required to read dirty pages or read pages that are modified or need to be modified, this can be paying off in the end. This, however, depends also on multiple parameters, for instance, the frequency of checkpoints. That means how large the log is you consider. Some more remarks about the rollback and the aborts. So usually in the normal operation, there are relatively few rollbacks to save points and transactions that are aborting. And also, which is kind of an intuitive or apparent observation, that the number of concurrent transactions you are allowing in the database, this is usually a parameter you can configure, this number of concurrent transactions is the upper bound for the number of loser transactions, right? This makes sense because if we're allowing 100 transactions to be running concurrently, then at most we can have 100 loser transactions. So on this slide, you see a classification of approaches for database recovery being caused by different assumptions or configurations of the systems. For instance, the page update strategy, the page replacement if we are doing steal or not steal, or commit handling if we are forcing writing back changes to disk at commit point in time, or no force, not to confuse, of course, with the force lock at commit rule. This was about steal and force, if you remember. Here we have different strategies for checkpointing, as we have discussed. And if you're combining these different, let's say the blue ones here, as a configuration of database systems or database system recovery, you see here some sample names of database systems which are employing these configurations or mechanisms. Most prominently here, of course, DB2 and Oracle. Now to conclude the recovery, this was quite a long part, right? And now we will look at multi-user concurrency control in more detail. Database recovery was motivated by the ACID requirement, in particular atomicity and durability. We talked about high availability, how we can achieve this, and then we came to the conclusion that we have to do log-based recovery. We looked at crash recovery mainly, so the system is crashing, the main memory is gone, and the hard disk is still there. And the observation is that we have to follow the write-ahead logging principle and the commit rule in order to guarantee correct restart of the system. We talked about redo winners only or redo all of them. And we, of course, in any case, have to undo the actions, the modification actions done in the database by the loser transactions. Important is that the restart operations, so undo and redo, are idempotent. We have seen how we can do this. For redo, it was quite apparent that it's working right away because of our page log sequence numbers. And for the losers, or for the undo operations, we had to introduce compensation log records. Finally, we also looked at checkpoints to limit the amount of data we have to read at the restart.